Hi, this is Johns Hopkins with Baltimore Heritage, and we're back with another of our 5 Minute Histories. And today we're going to go back to the 200 block of East Redwood Street, which is a wonderful block. And we're going to talk about everything from gargoyle statuary to the modern Olympics. And if you look over my left shoulder, you'll see some little figures from the Beijing Olympics that I thought I'd throw in there just for fun. All right, let's start with one of the oddest public artworks in Baltimore. And it's on the south side of Redwood Street on that block. And if you take a look at this and you say, that looks like a cannonball mounted on a piece of ironwork from a Conestoga wagon, you'd be right. And I think we don't know more than we do know about this building and about this piece of artwork. And if you know more, we'd love to hear from you. But what we do know is the cannonball is from the War of 1812. It was one of the bombs bursting in air that didn't burst, was given to the city by the family of one of the defenders. And it's mounted on a piece of Conestoga wagon. And if you think Conestoga wagons, that was out west, Oklahoma and all that. Well, you're right, but 100 years before, Conestoga wagons were coming out of the Conestoga region of Pennsylvania, up around York and Lancaster, I believe. And they were coming out to down to Baltimore, to Lexington Market, to fill up with dry goods and pots and pans, and heading west out to places like Hagerstown, or really west out to a place called Fort Duquesne, which we now call Pittsburgh. So how the cannonball got mounted on the Conestoga wagon, each of which has a Baltimore reference, but put together, I'm not sure how that came about, but would love to find out more if anybody knows. All right, let's slide down the block a little bit to the Totman Building. Same block, just the north side. This was built in 1906, and it was Baltimore Stock Exchange. And I want to mention three things about this. It's a great example of Beaux-Arts architecture in at least three ways. The first way is it's got a lot of ornamentation going on. It's got ribbons and it's got garlands and it's got fruits and it's just got a lot going on. That's one characteristic of Beaux-Arts. The second thing is Beaux-Arts architects took classical examples and reinterpreted them. And I think the best example here is if you look at the sides of the building, if you look at the sort of top and the bottom, there's the top little curl and to the bottom a base. That's a column, a freestanding column. Think of any building in the Acropolis, and flattened out and made to be part of the side of the building. The third thing is that architects in Beaux-Arts style wanted you to know what was going on the inside of the building by looking at the outside. And from the outside, you don't have to be super insightful to see that the main trading floor of this stock exchange building was on the second floor, not the first floor. All right, we're going to go across the street to our final building, and that's the Robert Garrett and Sons building, built in 1913 by Robert Garrett. His firm was actually founded by his grandfather, who kind of confusingly has the same name, Robert Garrett. But Robert Garrett builds this building in 1913. Before that, though, he was a student. He was in college at Princeton in the 1890s. And he was the captain of the track team. And his coach one day came to him and said, Robert, do you remember reading about the ancient Greek Olympics? Well, there's a bunch of people who are forming a modern Olympics in 1896 to take place in Athens. I think you should compete. And Robert said, that sounds good. He was pretty good at the shot put. And his coach said, you know, I think you should compete in the discus as well. The only problem was that Princeton didn't have a discus. Discus throw was not part of the American track circuit. But Princeton did have a classics department. So the coach and Robert walked across campus, found some classics professors and said, we need to know what a modern or what a discus looks like. And so they came up with the interpretation, looking at urns with figures on them and manuscripts, that a discus was about a foot and a half in diameter and weighed about 30 pounds. So Robert goes to the local blacksmith shop and has one manufactured and starts training with it, but he soon gives up. He says, this thing is way too heavy. I'm throwing it on my back. Yeah, I'm not doing it. I'm sticking to the shot put. He gets over to Athens in 1896 and he competes in the shot put, and lo and behold, he wins. He wins a gold medal in the first modern Olympics. And then he's kind of happy. He walks across the track to the other side and he looks down to the ground. He says, what's that? And somebody says, well, that's a discus. And he looks at it, and it's about 9 inches in diameter and weighs about 5 pounds. So Robert says, what the heck? I'm going to see if I can give this thing a try, too. He does it almost as a joke. The judges let him compete, but at the end, after everybody else who's already registered competes, And the two Greek champions are very graceful, apparently. They're just watching them is like watching ballet. And they hurl the discus out a great distance. Robert gets up there, and his first throw, it looks like a duck. Remember, he hasn't practiced at all with this thing, and he had only practiced a little bit with a 30-pound manhole cover. His second throw, and everybody's laughing, and Robert's laughing. His second throw, he does better, but he chucks it into the crowd. It almost beans one of the spectators. Everybody's still laughing, but on his third throw, Robert gets serious. And he's not graceful, but he's really strong. And on his third throw, he gets it right, and he hurls the discus out there. And when it lands 7.5 inches ahead of the Greeks. So Robert now is a two-time Olympic gold medalist. He goes on to win, I think, the silver in the standing long jump and in the high jump. And in 1904 in Paris, the second modern Olympics, he wins two more medals. So the first modern, in the age of the first modern Olympics, our own Robert Garrett was the winningest of the Olympians. He holds that title for a while, but eventually somebody else takes it away for a long time until our own Michael Phelps most recently, who is now the most crowned Olympian of all time. So we get to claim the first and the current, and probably the current for a long time. So I want to close by saying when in 1913, when the building was built after the 1904 fire, Robert Garrett builds into the building a modern gymnasium. And so maybe I'll leave you with the image of this somewhat aging Olympian investment banker who, instead of going out for big lunches, sneaks up to the gymnasium and continues to work out as the athlete that he is. All right, that's it for today, and we'll see you tomorrow.